Do you want to back announce as well? Be the proper hot choc you...
No, should we just talk about what happened during the record? Should we do that, Christian?
No,
I can tell that my time here is coming to an end. Because now, between the records, I'm getting people coming up to going, just sign this. No, it's just if you do that, I get a free iPhone. So
we'll have a word with Richie about that. Richie. Getting him to sign stuff so you get a free iPhone.
When does your iPhone come, Christian? When is that?
Richie,
how quickly is it coming through?
Getting him to sign stuff.
My headphones have...
what's that?
Something not working.
I'm going to have to speak to you about abuse of your position of power then, getting a guest today. I'm sorry about that, David.
It's quite all right, you know.
Yeah, and then the stuff that Richie's made you sign non-stop for his girlfriend as well.
Well, but you're never going to have an iPhone, are you, Christian? You've always said that. You're never going to...
It's 8 minutes past eight.
Sorry,
what's
that?
All across the UK now. So we're all very excited about David leaving. So listen then, what can we expect this weekend? Is it going to be as terrifying as
a spooky one. I mean, it's not, you know, it's not too terrifying. It's responsibly done. But, it's very exciting. The Waters of Mars, 7 o'clock on Sunday, which is the beginning of the end for the 10th Doctor.
And so it's split over three parts. We've got this Sunday, so the next Christmas.
This one kind of stands alone, but stuff starts in this episode that has repercussions at Christmas, yeah.
And I know, obviously, you've filmed the whole thing now.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's it. You'll never be Doctor Who again.
I know, I'm done.
And how does that feel? Are you excited? Is it... So you've been doing it for a few years, a big chunk of your life.
I know. It was kind of life-changing, yeah. And I don't really know how it feels yet. Maybe once they've gone out, I'll know if I feel proprietorial about it.
And how did you feel about the ending they've given you?
Brilliant.
Did you work closely with Russell?
No.
And
I just let him do it. Because he's the best writer on television.
Has it always been like that? You don't have much of an input.
Yeah.
You trust him to get
There's
on
no
with
need.
It.
There's no need. You know, my ideas wouldn't match up to his, so I just let him do it.
And did you get to spend some screen time with the new fella, Matt?
Well, that depends what happens in the final episode, doesn't it? Do you know what I mean? That would be a very revealing statement if I
Let me ask you this then. Have you met the new guy?
I've met the new guy, yeah. Yeah.
Did you meet him on the set of Doctor Who, the Christmas special? You won't get that with Jamie and Harriet.
No. You can switch over and hear that interview right now.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, up and down the dial. Yeah.
We did meet in Cardiff, yeah.
Which is where, of course,
Doctor Who is filmed. Yeah.
Yeah. And so what have you got coming up next then? You've obviously got this big thing, hopefully, fingers crossed, for this pilot in America.
I'm off to shoot that, but over Christmas, Hamlet. We've shot Hamlet. That's coming on BBC Two. St. Trinian's 2 opens on December 18th. I play the villain, Sir Piers Pomfrey, threatening lots of girls in short skirts, you know. And
Piers Pomfrey is the least threatening baddie name I've ever heard.
Really?
You wouldn't get that in a James Bond movie. Crikey, Bond, we need to go over to Cuba. Piers, what's he called?
Sir Piers Pomfrey.
Right, Sir Piers Pomfrey is playing up again. It sounds like a pompadour. It's like a lady's perfumer.
No, he's from the turn of the century style aristocracy.
Oh,
he's he was probably at the Billingdon Club with David Cameron. He's that kind of a villain.
He's one of the Billingdon boys, yeah?
He's one of the Billingdon boys, yeah.
Fantastic. And so if this American sitcom happens...
Sitcom? It's a drama, love.
Well, you know, sitcom drama, you know. Come on now. So is that what it is? It's a serious drama?
It's a drama, yeah. It's got funny bits in it, but it's a drama, yeah.
Like House.
I guess so.
Yeah. And you'll have to move out there. We'll never see you again.
Oh, listen, right now it's just a pilot, so who knows? But if I get a big swimming pool, you can come and visit.
Oh, I can come and visit. Not stay, did you hear that?
No. Yeah, there's some lovely hotels.
I'll get you some numbers. Yeah. And what we're going to do now, then, is because we've had lots of kids have been trying to call, right, all week to ask you questions.
Right.
I've interviewed lots of it. I've never seen such fervent fans of anything in my life. Your fans are out there, like, from 3:30 all this week. They're out there at 10 o'clock in the morning waiting for you, and it's pouring down with rain today
I know.
Did you have any idea that when you took over from Christopher Eccleston, you were going to be met with such ardent kind of fervour from the fans?
Well, you know that the kind of show it is, and you know that it has a lot of enthusiasm focused on it. So, but you don't really know what that's going to feel like, I suppose, until you're in the middle of it. And it can be quite overwhelming at times, yeah. But it's wonderful. Everyone, it's a very easy thing to be famous for, because people love it and they feel very kindly towards it and get excited about it.
How long did you agonise over the decision to leave?
I'd sort of always had it in mind that I'd leave now. At the same time as Russell T. Davis and Julie Gardner, the exec producer, we sort of decided we'd all go together. But then I had a little wobble and I thought, you know, maybe I could just stay a bit longer. Stephen Moffat, who's taken over, is the best writer
around. Yeah, he's
around
a hugely talented writer.
So the thought of working with him was very tempting. But in the end, I just thought, you have the courage of your convictions. It was never going to be an easy decision, so I took a deep breath and
so
left.
Did they not try and talk you out of it? Or did they
we talked about it, and I was very close to staying longer, actually. Yeah. Much closer than I ever thought I would be. And I did hum and haw a little bit. But at the end, I just thought, if I don't go now, I never will leave. And I don't want to still be there when people want to see the back of me. I'd rather go when there's a chance I'll be missed.
What's the deal with sort of writing and stuff in this country? So how come that you haven't been offered a good enough role that makes you want to stay in this country? Is it that your dream is you want to work in America? Or is it the lack of sort of really good projects that you've been offered?
No, it's not that at all. No, it's just you just sort of see what comes up. I don't have any particular... I don't think very tactically, or sort of, I don't have a kind of 5-year plan to conquer Hollywood or anything like that. It's just what comes up and what feels right at the time.
Because I think Rise to Candleford.
Yeah.
There's a job waiting for you there.
Mr. Pumplechook from Tadsworth.
There you go. Yeah, yeah. You can take the old St. Trinian's character and move it there. So listen, kids, I know loads of you have been trying to call in all week and we've been doing lots of stuff going on. We're going to do a thing now where we're going to take calls for Doctor Who, but only if you're 12 and under.
And no putting on a squeaky voice.
I was about to say, you know exactly what's going on next. We've got a very expensive 6-figure phone system here that can age your voice, okay? It's kind of like a carbon date your voice. So if there are any adults putting on weird voices, one that's creepy anyway, you need to take a good long hard look in the mirror if you're doing that this morning. But kids, call us now then with a question for David Tennant. 0330 123 1215. If you're 12 and under. Sometimes I feel like throwing my hands up in the air.